Welcome back, everybody. Let's keep talking about sampling distributions, and specifically, the distribution of sample means. In our last video, we defined what a distribution of sample means is, and we even created one from scratch. We learned that from a parent population of individual scores, we were able to create a distribution of all possible sample means. And although it was a lot of work, we learned that according to central limit theorem, we don't need to do all that work because we already know how the distribution of sample means is going to look. In other words, we already know its key properties. We know that that distribution of sample means is going to be normally distributed, which is good news because then we can convert sample means to z-scores and compute probabilities. In order to use z-scores, we need to know the mean of that distribution of sample means. You might recall we call that the expected mean. And then we also need to know how much variability there is from one sample mean to another. Well, it's really easy to know what the expected mean is, because the expected mean, in other words, the mean of this distribution of sample means, is equal to the mean of the parent population. Remember, I mentioned that parents and children often share similar characteristics. That's true in this situation as well. So the only other thing that we need to convert any sample mean into a z-score is some measurement of variability. And that's what the standard error of the mean is all about, and that's what we're going to focus on next. We often call the standard error of the mean just simply the standard error. And the standard error is simply a standard deviation for that distribution of sample means. When we were dealing with individual scores, the standard deviation represented, on average, how much the individual scores differ from the mean. So it was a measurement of variability when looking at individual scores. Now that we're dealing with sample means, the standard error is still a measurement of variability. What it measures is, on average, how much the sample means differ from that true population mean right in the middle. So one way that you can see it is that standard error is a measurement of sampling error. Remember, all of these sample means are trying to represent this population. And this population has a mean of 5. So some of these sample means don't equal 5. That means some of these sample means don't perfectly represent the population. Well, we want a measurement of how much sampling error exists, and that's what the standard error of the mean will provide us. The good news is that the standard error of the mean is very easy to compute using this simple formula right here. And you can see by looking at that formula, standard error of the mean is based on two primary factors. So in other words, the variability that we see here in the distribution of sample means is based on the variability that we see within the individual scores, and it's also based on the sample size. So it's based on sigma, which is the standard deviation of these individual scores, and it's based on n, which is the sample size. I think I mentioned this previously, but as our sample size increases, the standard error of the mean should decrease. And we're going to prove that to ourselves in just a minute. Let's just talk about it theoretically for a second. As the sample size increases, we're measuring more and more people. When we have more data, we should have more accuracy to our data because we're coming closer and closer and closer to measuring the entire population. So as we measure more and more people, the standard error of the mean, which is a measurement of sampling error, should decrease. So that's just something to look out for in the next couple of examples. What I want to do right now is practice computing standard error of the mean, and then we're going to put it all together. We're going to take a sample mean, transform it into a z-score, and then compute the probability of obtaining a sample mean of any given value. That's going to help us answer that key question, what's the probability of finding our sample data just by chance? In other words, what's the probability of finding our data just due to sampling error? This is a distribution of all possible sample means, and it's probably a little bit more realistic than the sampling distribution we were just looking at. I know that it's a distribution of sample means and not a distribution of individual scores because there are certain things I'm looking at that tip me off. For example, when I look at the x-axis right here, it's labeled x-bar, representing sample means. So that's telling me that sample means are plotted, not just individual scores. Another giveaway is that right there in the middle, mu sub e is plotted. That's the expected mean. That's the terminology that we use for the mean of the distribution of sample means. Remember, mu, which is the mean of the parent population, is equal to mu sub e, which is the mean of the distribution of sample means. But nonetheless, when I see that mu sub e, I know I'm dealing with the distribution of sample means. And what this graphic is showing us through all of these little boxes is that we have lots and lots of sample means that we find that are very close in value to the true population mean. But you see how there are fewer boxes at this high end and fewer boxes at this low end? Because it becomes very unlikely to find sample means that are very different than the true population mean, both on the high end and on the low end. So in these tails out here, these represent sample means that are pretty unlikely to occur just by chance. Let's look at this example right here, and we'll practice computing standard error of the mean. Again, when I look at this graphic, I can tell that I'm dealing with a distribution of sample means and not just a distribution of individual scores. I can see that the x-axis is labeled x bar, so that means we're plotting sample means. Although mu sub e is not listed, mu and mu sub e are equal, so oftentimes we're just going to see mu. But right here I also see sigma sub x bar, and that's the symbol that we use for the standard error of the mean. If I just saw a sigma, that would be a standard deviation, but sigma sub x bar is standard error of the mean. So seeing a symbol for standard error and seeing a symbol for a sample mean makes me know I'm dealing with a distribution of sample means. According to this information right here, this distribution of sample means was created from this parent population. And the way we read that is that this particular population of scores was normally distributed, that's what the N is, and it had a mean of 500 and a standard deviation of 100. So that's the population of individual scores, that's the parent population. It's that population of individual scores that gave birth to this distribution of all possible sample means. And according to this information right here, each sample had 25 scores in it. My question is, where does this value of 20 come from for the standard error of the mean? Let's switch views and then we'll compute it ourselves and we'll see that we'll replicate that value. So here we are with the distribution of sample means and here's the information about its parent population, mean of 500, standard deviation of 100. The first thing we want to do is prove that the standard error of the mean in this situation equals 20. And all we need to do is use this simple formula right here. Let's go ahead and do that. The standard error of the mean is based on two primary things. It's based on the standard deviation from the parent population, and it's also based on the sample size. Once we have that information, we can easily compute it. So the standard deviation is equal to 100, and we can see that the sample size is equal to 25. We need the square root of 25. If we simplify that, we'll have 100 divided by 5, which I can do in my head, that equals 20. And that is exactly what we find in the graphic right here. So we were able to replicate that the standard error of the mean in that situation equals 20. Let's talk about an important point though. What would happen to the standard error if the sample size was actually based on a larger value, 50 instead of 20? We should be able to predict what we would find based on two types of reasoning. So first, just take a look at that formula. You can see that if the sample size is going to change from 25 to 50, we're going to be dividing by a larger number. When we divide by a larger number, our answer gets smaller. So mathematically, it makes sense that as sample size increases, standard error of the mean decreases. And that general principle should also make sense from a more straightforward point of view. As I measure more people in each sample is becoming more representative of the population. So there should be less sampling error from one sample mean to the next. So let's prove that. We're predicting that the standard error of the mean, when based on a sample size of 50, will be smaller than 20. We start with sigma, which is the standard deviation from that parent population of individual scores. That was equal to 100. And now we need to divide by the square root of the sample size. And in this case, we're talking about the square root of 50. So we're going to have 100 divided by, let's figure out the square root of 50. I'm going to type in 50 and then hit the square root key. That equals about 7.07. So we're left with 100 divided by 7.07. Let's just go ahead and figure that out. 100 divided by 7.07. 0.07 equals 14.14. So our prediction is correct. When the sample size increases, standard error of the mean decreases. Let's take it a step farther. Let's start really putting it all together. Let's try to figure out where this 2 comes from. That 2 is simply a z-score. You're going to see right here, we're just going to modify our typical z formula so that it can accommodate sample means. Instead of an x in that formula representing individual scores, you now see an x bar representing sample means. And instead of a sigma in that formula representing standard deviation, you now see a sigma sub x bar, which represents the standard error of the mean. So we're trying to figure out where exactly in the distribution is a sample mean of 540. And because we're using z-scores, we're trying to measure how far is that sample mean from that true population mean right in the middle, 500, based on standard error units. So we're going to take that sample mean, which equals 540. We're going to subtract that population mean, which equals 500, and we're going to divide by the standard error. And in the original example, remember standard error was equal to 20. So we divide by 20. We're left with 40 divided by 20, which equals 2. So we were able to replicate this. What we're finding is that a sample mean of 540 is 2 standard errors above the mean. Remember, z-scores start getting big real fast. A z-score of 2 is really getting pretty big. Don't forget about the empirical rule. The empirical rule applies to standard errors just like it did with standard deviations. Within 2 standard errors above and below the population mean is 95% of all sample means. So that sample mean of 540, it's really pretty far out on the distribution. There's not much area left. Well, we can look it up. If we want to find the area in that little tail right there, all that we need to do is consult our z-table, look up a value of 2, and find the area in the tail. Here's our z-table. Let's scroll down until we see a z-score of 2. Right here is the row for a z-score of 2, and I want to look at this column right here. That column is labeled smaller portion. That's the area in the tail. So there's not much area in that tail. Just about 2.28% of the entire distribution is in that area. So in this case, 0.0228 or 2.28%. So what is the probability of randomly selecting 25 scores and finding a sample mean greater than or equal to 540 when we're pooling that data from a parent population that has a mean of 500 and a standard deviation of 100. That's only going to happen about 2% of the time. And make sure you're understanding why that's so rare. Remember, the parent population has a mean of 500. Most of the sample means should be right around 500. But we found a sample mean of 540. That's very unlikely to occur just due to sampling error. And I know my writing is atrocious, so here is a version of all those calculations that's a little bit easier to read. As I've said before, I know that's a lot of information to take in, but this is the good news. Everything that we need to know about a distribution of sample means and everything that we need to know about standard error of the mean, you've just learned it. All we need to do now is go through a few examples so that you're more comfortable with it. Well, that's enough for now. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.